Good evening. There's been a lot of great battles fought throughout history. Now, I'm no history buff, so I'm not going to bluff it up here, but I know there have been. I remember when I was studying in Europe for 3 months, studying abroad as part of my education at Freed Hardeman, we went and visited the site where Battle of the Bulge took place in World War II. And it's an area densely populated with woodland area. And all that we really saw was a monument with explanations and different things like that. But it's a fascinating battle to go and read about. And I remember sitting there at that monument, and you could actually go up and walk around on it, thinking about what it must have been like if I could have stood there and watched it unfold and see that battle take place in those woods and in the snow. Lots of great battles have been fought throughout history. I hope that I'm never personally in a battle of that nature. If so, you need to move to another country if I'm defending you, okay? But we all face a battle every day. And it's the battle that is far really more important than any physical battle. And it's the battle of spirit and flesh. Sometimes, as a Christian, you entertain these thoughts of, wouldn't it be easier to just give in? Wouldn't it just be easier to live how the world lives? No obligations. There's no higher power to answer to. We could give in to all of our impulses and all of our desires. Wouldn't that just be so much easier? Doesn't that sound great? And really, that's what Satan wants us to believe. And we know that the truth of the matter is that Satan never delivers on his promises. Yeah, he may his schemes may bring pleasure for a night or for a day, but you end up worse than how you began. Left on our own fighting this battle, we would all utterly fail. But thankfully, we're not asked to do it on our own. Our God offers His power and His strength and His support to the battle that we fight every day. And you know, if you think about it, that's really the message of the gospel, that we can't do it on our own, that God has intervened and helped us if we'll just follow Him and tag along for the ride. When we pick up our Bibles in Galatians chapter 5, I invite you to turn there this evening. We're not going to do a lot of flip-flopping around. So have it open on your laps, and I'll do that as well. And we'll just kind of talk about this battle. Galatians chapter 5. We're going to talk first that there are two opposing combatants in this battle. That's a pretty vicious battle going on the screen. The battle is between the flesh and the spirit. And the question is, well, what is the flesh? What does Paul mean by that? Is he saying that we have a sinful nature, that there's nothing that we can do? I don't think that's necessarily what he's talking about. Rather than trying to explain it, let's look at a biblical example, or let's think about it together. And let's go all the way back to Genesis chapter 3. When Eve was tempted in the garden, she saw that fruit. God had really only given one command, not to eat of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. And here's what the text says in Genesis chapter 3. She saw that it was good for food, a delight to the eyes, and desirable to make her wise. Fast forward to 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. John categorizes it this way: the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Okay. Now, I've never looked at fruit and thought that about fruit like Eve did. But she looked at that fruit and she said, you know what? This is the ticket. This is how I'm going to become like God. It's going to be good for my body. It's going to be good for my mind. And maybe God wasn't quite sure what He was talking about when He made that decree. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. You can really fit any sin ever that man could possibly come up with, and it can fit under one of those three categories. Satan tempted Jesus with those same three temptations: the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. So we've got clear biblical examples of what the flesh is. But I think we all know from personal experience what the flesh is, don't we? It's when you know you need to stay away from a certain thing or a certain group of people or a certain activity or a certain substance. And you keep finding yourself almost compelled to go back to it, and you fall short of God's glory again. It's seeing that sexy advertisement on the internet or on TV and maybe on a Super Bowl commercial, and you allow your mind to ponder over that image and see and to experience that excitement of that image. The flesh, we all know what it is. It's making that commitment on January the 1st to lose weight, and then on January the 2nd you drive by McDonald's. Okay? It's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. That's what flesh is. We've all been there. Maybe it's not McDonald's, maybe it's Arby's. It's a right turn. It's easier anyways if you're going that way. So you've got the flesh, and you've got the spirit. battling together. The spirit that dwells within us is battling with our flesh. And he wants the exact opposite for our lives. He wants us to live for him. He wants us to live for God. He wants us to crucify the flesh. He wants to crucify that old man of sin and live and walk everything by the Spirit. These two combatants have two contrasting desires. Our Christian life is a battleground between two opposing forces. They both cannot win in your life. Let that sink in. They both cannot be served. We either give in and we live according to our flesh, or we live to the Spirit of God. Really, we die to ourselves so that we can live by the Spirit. So we have two opposing combatants, the spirit and the flesh, but we've got two opposing lifestyles. There was going to be a football reference in here somewhere. The lifestyle of the flesh. In our passage tonight, Paul lists either 15 or 17 of them based on which translation you're using tonight. And they generally fall into about four different categories. And people have tried to categorize both of these lists, the flesh and the spirit, in different ways. But generally, in these, this lifestyle of the flesh that Paul lists fall into a few different categories. Sex or sexuality, religion, society, and drink. Let's read this passage together, verses 19 through 23. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. So Paul has this list here, these lists of the works of the flesh. And if you just kind of noticed as we read, on a surface level, there's a wide range of things here that Paul lists. I want to make just a few notes about this list. We're not going to go through every word. We're going to pick just a couple to talk about just to kind of set the stage. But a few notes here. I want you to think about first the wisdom of God and also his viewpoint on sin. If we were just to go around the room, if we were coming up with the Bible and we went around the room and we said, all right, so what are the sins that will keep you out of heaven? You know, what do you think, Bob? What do you think, Mr. Max? You know, we just went around the room. I don't know if we would say some of the, I mean, envying, jealousy. I mean, is that what we would come up with? I tend to think we'd go for the extreme things, the bad, big sins would keep us out of heaven. But when we put ourselves in the mind of God, and that's what we ought to be trying to do, is think about everything the way God thinks. And that's a lifelong battle, by the way. But we really realize that all sin is bad. All sin put Jesus on the cross, the little sin from our perspective or the big sin from our perspective. And I use those terms with air quotes, okay? Because all sin put Jesus on the cross. All sin can keep us out of heaven. So I want you to think about first the wisdom of God. I want you to think also about the word practice. I think we all understand there's a difference between one who practices such thing on a regular basis. They regularly, on a daily or weekly basis, give into these things, maybe even deliberately, because they enjoy it or they really don't want to change their life. That's one thing versus someone who occasionally slips up. We all make mistakes. We all fall short of God's glory. We all struggle with the sins of the flesh, and we all have our own vices. But we're all trying to walk in the light. And we have those moments of weaknesses, but there's a difference there. One who practices versus one who stumbles and falls, but immediately turns back to God. Some of the greatest people in Scripture, all of them actually, sinned and fell short of God's glory. But someone like David was willing immediately to confess his sins, to go back to God, to beg for repentance. And that's why he's called a man after God's own heart. It's not because he was perfect. It's not because he was better looking or a better servant than everyone else. It's because he had the heart that was tender and willing to admit his mistakes and go to God for help. Another note here, I want you to notice the stern warning that Paul gives in verse 21. He says, at the end of verse 21, of which I told you, or which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in times past. Now, I personally am not quite sure if Paul had ever visited Galatia. I'm not sure that he did. I could be wrong on that. But at some point, he had talked with these Christians. He'd warned them before. And what's he doing now? He's warning them again. He's concerned about them. These things will keep you from the kingdom of God. The big sins, the small sins. If you practice such things, you will not inherit God's kingdom. And those who walk by the Spirit, which we're going to talk about in a minute, but those who walk by the Spirit do not practice these things. Think about that. Look at that list again in your Bibles. And ask yourself, is there something in there that could describe my life? Is there something in there that is a habitual thing that I struggle with? Because if that's the case, you need to make changes in your life. And I need to make changes in my life if there's something in there that I need to get out of my life. We're going to talk about just a few of these very briefly, of the bad list here, the works of the flesh. First, let's talk about that word impurity very briefly for just a moment. Or uncleanness is how it's translated in the New King James. That's a simple concept. It's a broad term. And it talks about or refers to our cleanliness or our uncleanness in our thoughts, in our words, and in our deeds. I love the psalm which says, May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you. All of those things comprise the totality of who we are. Do we have some uncleanness in the things that we might watch or listen to or think about? Chances are we all struggle with that from time to time. Let's not make that a practice of ours. Let's not make that a habit of ours. Let's not make that something we're just okay with, and we'll get to it later. So, impurity or uncleanness. The next word in verse 20 is sorcery. And this is one I've always kind of wondered about. Okay, I don't worry about it, but I wonder about this one. Because what does Paul actually mean there? And that word can mean a couple of different things, three to be exact. First, that word sorcery, which comes from the Greek word pharmakeia, which is kind of where we get the idea of pharmacy, can mean a few things. First, it can talk about or mean legitimate drug use for medicinal purposes. Okay, I don't think that's what Paul has in mind here. The second meaning of this word could be the misuse of or abuse of drugs or alcohol to alter one's state of mind. And then the third meaning that this could mean is the practice of witchcraft or the occult, which almost always involved the use of drugs to put one in trance or something like that, to alter one's state of mind. Okay, so that word could just generally mean a perversion of the proper use of drugs, is what Paul has in mind here. And then we're going to end on this section with how Paul ends. He says, and things like these, or and the like. You'll notice what Paul is saying is this list is not exhaustive. You know, you can imagine a Christian getting this letter from Paul and being worried. Is my sin on this list? Is my sin here anywhere? Oh, thank goodness. I'm in the clear. I can keep doing my thing. That's not what Paul is trying to get at. He's trying to show that this list is not inclusive. Because a Christian who walks by the Spirit, which is what this passage is about, should be able to discern and realize the difference between the two different works, between the two different sides going on in our life. We should be able to look at an issue, to look at a behavior, and make some sort of judgment call on it based on our knowledge of God's Word and how He would want us to live our lives. You know, if the internet had existed in Paul's day, he would have had to triple the length of this letter to include all the sins that one could commit. And that's why we look at Bible principles. When you have God's Word in your heart, when you have your heart in the right place, you're going to be able to look at an activity or something and be able to discern, is this really something that a Christian should be involved in? So Paul has this huge list of things that will keep you out of heaven and things like these or and the like. We need to be able to make that distinction in our own lives. And we need to do that carefully. We need to do it prayerfully, and we need to do it together. That needs to be something that we have open conversations about. So we've got the lifestyle of the flesh, but we have the lifestyle of the Spirit there. Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. As much as that previous list is disgusting and ugly and vile, and something we should want to stay away from, this list is beautiful. Something that we should strive to produce in our lives. And I love that idea that I've often called this the fruits of the Spirit. But Paul says that it's the fruit of the Spirit, singular. And I take that to mean that all of these things should be present in the life of the Christian in some capacity. We're going to have strengths, we're going to have weaknesses and things we need to be working on, but this fruit needs to be evident in our lives. There's been different ideas about how to categorize these fruit that Paul lists. But I like this one. Love, joy, and peace characterize our relationship with God. Patience, kindness, and goodness characterize our relationship with others. And this commentator said that faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control is a portrait of Jesus Christ. They grow steadily and naturally like fruit does in our world today. Let's talk very briefly and unpack a few of these fruit. The first I want to talk about is joy. You know, sometimes I'll look around at my life and the life of other Christians, and I think, are we really as joyful as we should be? When we think about how blessed we are and all that God has done for us and the opportunities that we have, and sometimes it seems like we let our faith feel like work. And I love the psalm that says, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." Because we can lose it. And we can get caught up in the minutiae of the Christian life and focus so much on one step, we don't focus on the destination anymore. Sometimes we need to have our joy restored. Joy is simply gladness or delight, especially in response to what God has done for us. And I've always understood joy to be on a deeper level than surface level happiness. Joy comes from deep within. And that needs to be something that we need to look at our own lives and ask, am I joyous about my faith? Am I joyful about what God has done for me? Because if I'm not, I'm doing something wrong. Because that's a fruit of the Spirit. The next one is goodness. And the definition that I have is that goodness here is generosity that reaches beyond what is due. And genuineness is encapsulated in that word of goodness. And then the last one I want to briefly mention is gentleness. It's hard for me to describe someone who is gentle. I have here that it's a humble and kind demeanor, someone who is willing to help or calm another. And that makes a good definition, but when you meet somebody who's gentle, you usually recognize that, don't you? And when I do, I think, man, I want to be like that person. I want to have that gentle spirit. I want to have that gentle answer. Sometimes I'm too abrasive. I'm too harsh in how I speak to my wife and how I speak to my friends and how I speak to my Christian family. How I speak to my own family, that's another issue altogether, okay? But we're too harsh. We need to work on our gentleness, and being gentle, and also how we talk to other people. And that includes Facebook as well, and what happens on the internet. Let's work on our gentleness together, because we need to be cultivating that in our lives. Just like the bad list of the works of the flesh, I get the feeling that this is probably not an exhaustive list. And I'll give you a couple reasons why. Paul mentions righteousness and hope as a fruit in Romans 14 and 15. And Peter lists an entire list of Christian graces in 2 Peter chapter 1. Some of those overlap, some of them don't. But Paul is setting the stage, and he's trying to paint a picture for us. What does the Christian life look like? If God is at work in someone's life, what's it look like? And here it is, the fruit of the Spirit. So we've got these two opposing lifestyles, but we have two opposing allegiances. We're called to cast aside the desires of the flesh. We're called to surrender to God. And Paul says in verse 24, he says, "And those who are Christ's, or those who belong to Christ, have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." It's this picture of this, we have what you might call this old man of sin. And when we became a Christian, we nailed that man or that woman of sin to the cross. And we need to leave it there. And what Paul is kind of saying, or at least this is how I understand it, when we go back to those sins, like a dog returning to its own vomit, as the Bible would say, it's like we're revisiting the scene of the crucifixion. And sometimes we don't just visit it, we camp out there. And we don't leave that old man behind. We don't leave that old woman behind, that woman or man of sin. We've got to leave it there. Let's stop returning to the scene of our own crucifixion. There are only two choices. Right now, your life is either being directed by the Spirit of God through His Word, or your life is being directed by the desires of your flesh. One happening in your life will prevent the other from taking place. It's mutually exclusive. You cannot have it both ways. You can't have a foot in the door in God's Spirit, and you can't have a foot in the door by your flesh. It doesn't work that way. And as we think about this idea, about this allegiance, and what side are we going to choose, and how are we going to do this, we need to have the right attitude, first of all. Because I find that sometimes we have the wrong attitude about this. For example, some might have the attitude that this seems like an impossible task. Is it really worth it to fight this battle? Is it really worth it to work on myself on a regular basis? Because if we're honest with ourselves, change is hard. We don't like to change, okay? We don't like to change pews. We don't like to change our style or our hairstyle. We don't like to sometimes change houses or change cars because we like the old one. Who wants the new stuff? We don't like change. But becoming a Christian and being a Christian is about continually changing and upgrading ourselves. And we had this idea that maybe it's not worth it, but the battle has already been won. The price has already been paid. And Satan has only as much power as you and I allow him to have in our lives. Sometimes we start thinking that they're equal. The powers that be are equal. They're not. Satan has only as much power as you give him. And unfortunately, sometimes we give him way too much power. And we do that when we try to get by on our own and our own human wisdom. Another thing that I hear about having the right attitude is I've heard before that, that's just the way I am. And maybe this happens after an argument or somebody loses their cool. Well, that's just how I've always been. And like that's just a get out of jail free card to not change anything about our lives. And I've said it. We've all said it. That's just the way I am. Or you're maybe a little impatient. Well, that's how God made me. So get over it, pretty much. Right? No, that's not how it needs to be. If you ever hear yourself say that phrase, you need to take this hand and put it right here, okay? Because that's where it needs to go. We need to make that change in our lives. And it bothers me when I hear people say that. Because as much as it bothers me, I think it bothers God. For God to hear someone say that, I'm content with the way I am. I don't know about that. I don't think God's okay with that. So we need to have the right attitude. But I want to ask this question before we conclude. Is how do we cultivate these things in our lives? How do we cultivate the things of the Spirit? And I'm going to give a few suggestions, and then the lesson will be yours. First and foremost, and most obvious to anyone at all who's ever heard a sermon, is that you have to know. You have to know what God says through His Spirit, what the Spirit has revealed in His Word. You have to know it. David said in Psalm 119:11, "Your Word I've hidden in my heart that I may not sin against you." He could not sin because he had God's word so treasured up in his heart. How else are we going to know what God wants? How else are we going to know God's mind or his thoughts? How else are we going to shape our conscience and shape our lives and shape our will to what God wants us to do? There's no other way. You have to know what God's word says. And by the way, you don't learn that on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights and Wednesday nights. You learn that every single day. And that's your responsibility. But you got to know that. And then we also can do that by constant prayer. You know, when you find weaknesses in your life, pray about that. God, I haven't been as loving as I need to be lately. God, I haven't been as patient as I need to be lately. God, my faithfulness is slipping. God, I don't have as much joy anymore. Help me to find that joy. Lord, restore to me that joy of my salvation. We can pray the same prayers the psalmist prayed. Be careful what you pray for, though. God may send you some opportunities to work on that. You may say, God, pray for patience, and God sends you a situation that is going to test your patience. Consider that an opportunity to change. So you've got to know, if you want to cultivate the things of the Spirit, you've got to know what God says, and you've got to pray about it. And then I think you've got to seek God's kingdom above all else. Matthew 6:33. We've got to be so consumed with the things of God that we don't have room for the works of the flesh in our lives. I mean, I think sometimes the reason why we struggle with sin so much is that we're not doing what we need to be doing. There's an old story, and I'm going off the cuff, so this may crash and burn, but it's a folk tale about some three men who wanted to go and they wanted to fish for the weekend on the lake. And so they got there, and day one, it was bad weather, so they stayed in the cabin because they couldn't get out and fish. Well, day two rolled around, it was bad weather, they couldn't get out and fish, and by day three, they were just going at it in the cabin. And the point was that if they were able to do what they went there to do, which was to fish, then they wouldn't have been bickering and fighting so much. Maybe sometimes we bicker and we fight and we have bad attitudes because we're not actually out getting and doing the things that God wants us to do. We don't actually have the right priorities. God says, seek first the kingdom, not our own wealth or our own glory or our job promotion or whatever it may be. Seek first the kingdom. And everything else is going to take care of itself. Matthew 6:33. So you've got to know what God says. You've got to pray about it. You've got to put His kingdom first. And you've got to put Christ on every day. You've got to wake up every day and make that decision to die to yourself. Today, I'm going to leave my man of sin on the cross, and I'm going to put Christ on. Romans 13:14, one of the few references tonight outside of Galatians, Paul says, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Paul basically says, if you've got Christ on and you're not even thinking about sin, then you don't have to worry about it. Those are just a few suggestions for how we can cultivate the things of the Spirit. And it's up for you to take those and make them a reality in your life. I want to think tonight about a few final little notes as we kind of wrap it up here. I want to look at two verses directly from the context of Galatians that kind of can continue this idea of telling us, how can we do this? Look what Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. He says, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That kind of goes along with what we talked about earlier. If we're so consumed with that, then we're not going to have to worry about the lust of the flesh. And then, in kind of a concluding statement, turn to Galatians chapter 6, verse 8. Paul says there, for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Paul essentially says, he says, okay, I've made the lists. Here you go. You wanted a list about what you could and couldn't do? Well, here it is. Okay? And then he says, be careful about what you choose. Be careful about what seeds you plant in your life and which garden you cultivate, because there's some consequences here. And he says, if you reap the flesh, it leads to corruption. That's it. But if you reap the Spirit and the things of the Spirit in your life, you're going to reap life. You're going to reap everlasting life. Let me ask you this. Doesn't a life marked by joy and peace and love and gentleness and faithfulness, doesn't that sound infinitely better than a life marked by strife and envy and hatred and all those other things that Paul listed? Doesn't it? But there are droves and droves of people whose life are marked by anything but the Spirit. And they live in that because that's all they know. They don't even know what they're missing. It's our responsibility to go out and tell them the good news, that they don't have to give in to those desires anymore. And neither do you tonight. These things that we've talked about tonight, they need to be evident in your life. And I'm not going to sit here and try to judge your heart. I'm not going to sit here and try to tell you that you're going to hell because you're not good enough for God. But I do believe that God has called us all to be what I believe Marshall Keeble said, that we all should be fruit inspectors. Okay, I can't inspect your heart. The Bible makes it very clear. When Samuel was looking for David, God told him that, I don't see like man sees. God look at the heart, but man gets stuck on the outward appearance. And the implication is that man can't see the heart. I don't see like man sees, because man can only see the outside. But we can look at each other's lives, and we need to be doing that. Do I see those in myself? Do I see them in my family? Do we see them in each other? But if not, we need to have some healthy conversations about why that's the case and what we can change. They need to be evident in our lives. And if we were left on our own, you know, we might. If I spent my whole life working on patience without God, I could probably pull it off. But I might not have the other ones down. But with God's help, you can develop them all. You may not have them all perfectly, and you probably never will, but you'll be working on them every day of your life. I want to ask you the question tonight, who's guarding your steps? Who or what is guiding your steps better, the Spirit or the flesh? You can't have it both ways. Tonight, I don't know where your heart is at spiritually. I pray if there's someone out there who wants to put Christ on in baptism and dedicate their life to Him, that they'll do that tonight and not wait another moment. It's the most important thing in the world, not a football game. But I pray also if there's someone out there tonight who needs the prayers of the church, you can do that too tonight. And whatever it is, you can do that as we stand and as we sing.